Thank you. Wow. So occasionally I do trainings during my work, and the hardest part for like a training day is the hour or so right after lunch, because everybody is filled up on carbs, and you see them, they kind of get a bit sleepy, and then we all had pizza. Awesome. I will try not to bore you to sleep, but I'm not making any promises. So Johan has now talked about the framework. So now it's time to talk a bit about the tooling around the framework, and more specifically the Qt Creator IDE, also coming out of the Qt company, and I think it's mostly developed in their Berlin office. So I will structure this presentation kind of like first a bit of an intro, some slides, or actually one slide, with a bit of an intro on what you can expect from Qt Creator in terms of support, project support, compiler support, platform support, etc. And then I will do a demo, and I will spend probably most of my time on the demo, because that's kind of where it matters anyway. Before we get started properly, though, a few words about myself. My name is Tobias Nätterlund, as Harald mentioned. I work for KDAB, which is a consulting company focusing on Qt, C++, and OpenGL, and services. We're focusing on services, trainings, migrations, profiling, optimizations in those areas. And I think even Johan mentioned in the beginning of his presentation that we're one of the largest contributors to Qt, to the actual framework itself. Right, so getting started on the actual topic at hand, Qt Creator. As Qt itself is cross-platform. Of course, Qt Creator is cross-platform. So you can run it on Linux, you can run it on macOS, you can run it on Windows, which means, of course, that if you want to switch to this, unless you're already using it. So actually, do a show of hands. How many has heard of Qt Creator before? How many is using it? Okay, not too bad. But let's say you want to switch to it, but you're sitting on Windows, you're familiar with the environment, but of course, since Qt Creator is cross-platform, you don't have to switch platform. You can still run it on Windows and be comfortable in that environment without having to learn a bunch of other things while switching. And so it runs on all these three major platforms, and I bet you, with some patience, you can even get it to run on a Raspberry Pi if you're feeling motivated to spend some time on it. For project support, so what it actually, when you're working with it, it of course supports the two major project types from Qt, that's QMake and QBS. But let's say you're not writing a Qt project, so you don't wanna rely on or depend on the Qt libraries, you can do a CMake project and have it pure C++ with some additional libraries if you want, but you don't necessarily have to use Qt just because you're using Qt Creator. And there's also out-of-tool support if you want to use that for project management. A developer environment without an editor would kind of suck. So of course there is editing support. And when I say there is editing support for C++, QML, and JavaScript, because those are the three major languages that you use for Qt development, when I say they have support for it, it goes beyond just being a fancy text editor with some syntax highlighting. Qt Creator actually parses your code and creates a code model behind the scenes. So it will use this code model, so it knows your code in a way more detailed way than just being just parsing a pure text file and highlighting that one based on the content. It actually knows your code. So that code model is then the base for all the code completion and all the refactorings and the syntax highlighting as well. So it knows your code in a way more detailed way than just a regular text editor. Of course, you can also throw in basically any other text file in there as well and get syntax highlighting as well, but it won't parse it and create the code model for, let's say, Python or Perl. It will just highlight it. If you're familiar with KDE and Kate, the text editor there, they are actually sharing the same highlighting engine. So you can download the definitions that Kate uses and use then those in Qt Creator as well. And also, as mentioned, if you have any questions whatsoever during the presentations, feel free to interrupt me, and I'll try to answer them to the best of my knowledge. There is also a built-in designer inside Qt Creator that allows you to either drag and drop widgets if you're creating a widget project, or you can set up a Qt Quick project and start designing there. Most often, though, used for mockups. I will show you the widget designer during the demo, just for the sake of showing you that it's there, and kind of how you can use it as well. For building, again, it comes back to being cross-platform. So depending on what platform you're on, it will use a different backend. But normally, when you build stuff in Qt Creator, it will use your make tool. So it will invoke make, or it will invoke nmake, or jom, or cmake, or whatever. But it will have support for the compilers in the backend for parsing their output, for example, and being able to show you where in the code you actually messed up. So you get some small annotations in your code file saying this is where it went wrong. So on Linux and Mac, it will use GCC or Clang. And on Windows, it will use MSVC as the compiler backend. There's also, of course, debugging and test support. So if you're on Linux or Mac, it will use DDB as the debugging backend, but you will get a visual debugger inside Qt Creator. And if you're on Windows, it will use the CDB debugger. And I'm not entirely familiar with Windows. I'm not entirely sure whether that's being shipped with Visual Studio or if you have to download it separately. But it's from Microsoft, so you might have to download it yourself. Not entirely sure. There's also a built-in built-in JavaScript debugger that you can use to debug your QML or your imperative JavaScript code inside your QML files. But as Johan mentioned, you should not do that. You should just use C++. There is Valgrind support for checking mem leaks, for example. There is a QML profiler to kind of see where in your QML files you're spending your time. So if you're looking at the startup of your application and you see you're spending five seconds loading PNG files, you might want to do something about that. But so there's this nice little timeline you get when you launch your QML applications in the profiler. There's also test support, either just for the pure Qt test framework or for the Google Auto Test framework as well. And if you're in the situation where you're sitting on your desktop machine, but you're not really building for that platform, but you're building for, let's say, QNX or Android or some IMX board or a Raspberry Pi, you can, of course, do that inside Qt Creator and just click play, and it will upload and run or possibly debug as well on that device. And switching between the targets is quite nice as well. The only small caveat is that if you're building towards iOS, I believe you still need to be on macOS to do that, because you do need the Xcode tools. So you can't, as far as I know, you can't cross-compile for iOS on Linux, for example, because you still need the stuff that the tools that Mac and Apple provides to actually upload and create the packages for iOS. And as a last point before the demo, Qt Creator is completely open source. It's GPL3 licensed. So if you're feeling inclined to, feel free to contribute to it. It's a matter of just cloning the Git repository and submitting code reviews or patches for code review and see whether you get them through or not. Questions so far? Complete silence. All right, then let's do the demo. Yeah. So this is what Qt Creator looks like at first startup. And this is with a completely blanked out config file, because I didn't want to show any customer projects. People wouldn't like that. So this is what you get when you first start it up. And before we get started on creating a new project, I actually just want to show you, I'm not sure you can read this from the back. Is it somewhat readable? Okay, perfect. So before we get started on creating a new project, I just want to show you a few things in the options dialog. And more specifically, I want to show you the kit setup, because that's what Qt Creator calls kind of like targets. They call them kits. And a kit is made up from a bunch of different tools and a target platform. And the tools it's made up from is partly the CMake, which CMake binary to use for if you're using CMake project, which debugger to use, and which compilers, or rather, well, the compilers that QCreator knows about. And these three are most often simply auto-detected on your system when QCreator launches. Unless, of course, you cross-compile your own GCC or you have a specific tool chain, then you might need to add it manually. Then you have your, additionally, you have your Qt versions. And in this case, the three of them that I have installed in this specific machine are also auto-detected. If I would have some other ones that I built myself, I would have to add them manually just to have them to show up. And the four of these plus the target, as I said, make up a kit. So in this case, I have two kits, one for a desktop targeting Qt 5.6.2 and a 64-bit GCC, and one for targeting Qt 5.9.0, also with a 64-bit GCC on a desktop. Go away. And we can see for the kit that it's targeting a device, a desktop device, and it's targeting my local PC. I can set up a sysroot for this specific kit. So if I'm cross-compiling, for example, I do need a, do you want the C compiler? I'm using, well, these compilers, I'm using this GDB for the debugging backend. And I'm, in this case, I can't choose the Qt version because it's auto-generated. But if you create your kit manually, you can switch Qt version as well. And you can select make spec if you want, often also only used when you're cross-compiling. And then the CMake tool. And these two kits, now right now I'm only targeting desktop, but if I would target, let's say Android or QNX, I would have additional manual kits here listing, okay, I'm using this Qt version for Android and I'm targeting this specific device. So if you're having two Android devices, one Nexus and one, whatever, Samsung, something, you would have two kits. And the point of these kits is that you can switch between them very easily when you're developing. So you can have one project targeting a desktop kit and an Android kit. And then when you're building, you can say, okay, now I want to build for the desktop kit. And then when you're done, you can, okay, my feature is done, I want to test it on my device now. You simply just switch over to the Android kit and you build for that one instead. So it's quite easy. I'll show you that in a bit. So for creating a new project, just a matter of launching the wizard. I'm not sure how much Johan actually showed you of this because I wasn't here due to the training mishap, but I'll run through the wizard anyway. So when you start a new project, you can choose between a various number of application projects. So widget application, or pure console application if you don't want any GUI at all. Qt Quick and Qt Canvas 3D. You can also do some libraries, like a C++ library or a Qt Creator plugin. Auto tests, subdir project, just for having a project collecting one collection of projects. Plain C or plain C++ applications as well. Or you can import it from various source repositories or version control repositories. But for the sake of this demo, I'm just going to do a Qt widget application. So I'm picking that one and giving it a name. And now I'm getting to the kit selection. So this is where I can select. Now I only have two desktop kits, of course, but if I had Android, this is also where I would pick, okay, I want to build this project for Android as well. But I'm picking both my desktop environments because I want to show you, or both desktop kits because I want to show you how you can switch between them later on. And then you can also get to choose what kind of profile or what kind of build configurations you want to do. In this case, we're doing debug, release, and profile builds for both kits. So this means I will have six different options to choose from. And then, of course, this is where the various build files will end up, and also my binaries. It won't create all these folders right now. It will only create them when I build. So it won't clutter the file system unless I'm actually selecting to build one of these. For the next part is simply choosing what kind of widget we want to have as a top level. So I'm using a QWidget base class and just naming it my widget. And I can also add this to a Git repository if I want to. And then we'll simply finish. And this brings us into the actual code. Let me just zoom in a bit. So this is what QCreator looks like when you actually have some code opened. You have your main view showing the code, of course, that you're interested in. And then you have, on the kind of left-hand side, you have a few different visualizations of the project or of the files. So in this case, we're having two. We're having one that lists kind of the project structure and one that lists the open documents. But we can switch these to show, well, other things. We can show the file system layout of the project folder, and I can browse around in the file system. I can show a include hierarchy of the current file I'm looking at. And I can switch these, or I can split these and show additional include hierarchy. So I can split these and show additional lists. So depending on what I'm interested in. And the same applies, of course, to the right-hand side as well. So you can have lots of these if you want to. But normally, what I normally do is having some sort of, well, this view more or less, just for the sake of clarity. Then on the even further on the left-hand side, you have your mode selector. So we can go, we have the welcome mode, which is essentially the first page that you see when you launch. We have our editing mode. Then we have our design mode, which we'll get to in a bit. We have our debug mode, which is the view that we'll actually end up in when we launch our debug session. We get to see our stack trace and the breakpoints and the locals and the various variables we have. Then we have our project set up. This is a bit wider than I expected. We can switch, we can change the build settings and the run settings for the two different kits. So again, these two kits show up here. So you can go and change the build environment or the parameters for make, for example, if you want to pass in -j or whatever. And the same applies for the run configuration. We can change the run environment or the QML profiler setting or the background settings, for example. Then the final mode we have is the help mode, which is essentially just the, once it shows up, the Qt documentation. Yeah, there we go. So I can go and look for, let's say, the documentation for QLabel, and I get the full documentation for that specific class. And the same can be accessed from within the editor as well, simply by pressing, having your cursor on a specific type and pressing F1. You're seeing a small version of this on the side, and then you can press F1 again, and you're seeing the full documentation. Then on the bottom left, we have our target selector, and this is where the kits show up again. So by clicking this button here, I can choose between the two kits I configured, as well as the different build configurations for it. So I can say, okay, now I'm building in debug mode for Qt 5.6.2, but I can instantly change this to release mode for Qt 5.9.0 and start building for that instead. So that's just how you switch between the different targets. So if I would have an Android target here, it would actually show up, and I can choose to build for Android instead. Then we have our play button, which is, well, runs the application or builds and runs it depending on your configuration. We have our debugging button for starting it in debug mode. And then we have our small hammer for actually start building the project. Then on the bottom, we have a few output panes, but the one of the things we do have before the output panes is what's called the locator. And I will actually get back to this later because it's quite a vital part in QCreator. But we have our output panes, one listing the compilation or the compilation issues. One is in search results, application output, sort of standard out and standard error from the application. Compile output, debugging console, and test results. So that's essentially it for how the kind of the UI is structured inside QCreator. So now I'm simply going to show you quickly the designer, and that's done by opening a UI file, which the wizard set up for me previously. So that brings me into the design mode, which allows me to drag and drop various widgets onto my canvas or my widget here. I won't do anything functional. I just drag and drop a few widgets. You can see how it works. But I can choose between the widgets that are available to me inside Qt to create my UI. So I'll do a list view. just drag and drop that onto the canvas, and I'll add a few buttons as well. Oops, add and delete. And then we'll add a spacer just for getting the layout nice. And I'll create a vertical layout and then a horizontal layout. And then it's looking decent. I also, of course, want to change the names of these because these are now called as variable names that I can access from the C++ code, push button and push button underscore two. Not very descriptive names, so I'll simply rename them to add button and delete button. And this is also the view where you get to see all your properties, if I can resize, of this specific object that you've selected. So you get to see the like the text property, the whether it should be checkable, what kind of, well, if it's enabled, what kind of style sheet it has, what kind of font it has, etc. So you can go in and change these in the design mode.
So if you go back and forth between the C++ code and do the change names get lost? So can you rename it without problems?
That's a good question. Because you can do that on the pure C++ code. I actually have to try it and see what happens. Okay. Yeah. Remind me in like 5 minutes and we'll do it. Actually, we can do it now because that's my next step anyway. So when you're creating these UIs, you do it in a .ui file. And this is, if I open it up in editing mode, that's just XML. And this is during the compilation phase being transferred into or transformed into, compiled into C++ code. And put into a generated header, in this case called ui_mywidget.h. And we haven't built the code yet, right? We haven't pressed compile or control B or anything. So if I try to open this file, it says I can't open it because it doesn't exist yet, because the compiler hasn't run yet. So I have no idea what that is. But this kind of connects down to the code model that I mentioned in the beginning that QtCreator actually has. Because if I do ui dash or ui pointer, UI is the instantiation of my UI file. I can actually already now access my add button from here, despite the member actually not really existing yet because it's not compiled, but Qt knows about it, or Qt Creator knows about it anyway. So now we want to see what happens if I rename this, right? And that's done by pressing Ctrl-Shift-R.
Nope.
It will change it in the header file, in the generated header file, but it won't change it in the UI file. So no, that will break things if you do. Sorry. Right, we can leave that. That was actually getting ahead a bit of myself there, but okay. Adding a new function. Let's say we're gonna add a slot to this class. Delete item, let's call it, and we're going to hook it up to the delete button later. I have it in my header file, but I also, of course, want it in my CPP file because I want the actual code to be somewhere. And I can copy paste and I can move into my CPP file and paste it and add the class :: whatever. Or I can press Alt Return or Alt Enter, and I get three options. I can choose to add it to my to the CPP file, or I can choose to add it outside the class, which simply just puts it down here. Or I can add it inside the class, which just puts it after the method definition or declaration. So I'm going to go for the mywidget.cpp option, and I add it, and it's automatically it's added to the CPP file, and I get my cursor in there, so I can start typing right away. Not going to do anything fancy. Nope. Do that. Just for the sake of, I will get back to that. I can, of course, also add, parameters to my already existing methods and have that show up as well. So let's say we add a window title parameter to my constructor. And now it's not visible because the screen isn't wide enough, but there is actually a small light bulb on the end of the line. And that light bulb kind of tells me there is something you can fix here. There's something you can do. So I can press Alt Return again, and I can say apply function signature changes, and that will add my my newly added parameter to the CPP side as well. Or I can add an additional constructor in my widget.cpp if I want to. But we want to apply it, and going back and looking at the CPP file, it is now added to the constructor list, even on the C++ side or in the CPP side. And I get a small warning as well saying, you haven't used this variable, so you might want to do that. So we're simply going to use it. But then I figured out, okay, I want to rename this one, just simply naming it title. Again, I'm getting the light bulb over here somewhere. So I'm pressing Alt Return, and again, I'm getting apply function signature changes. I do that, and I'm back, and it renames the title, and it also fixed the usage of it. So it doesn't break my code just because I renamed it in the header file. So that's quite convenient. The same applies to local variables. So this for loop I have, pressing Control Shift R for renaming gives me this little editor, which is only applied to my variable itself. So if I want to name this I instead, I'll simply name it I, and it replaces it on all locations instantaneously. That's quite neat. In terms of navigation, maybe you've seen it already. F4, if so switching between CPP file and header file. Or you can do, let's go somewhere useful. Let's go there. You can do F2 for switching between declaration and definition. So I'm getting to my constructor, jumping between those two. And then if I go into the delete item and press F2, I get moved down into the delete item function. Of course, you can also just click around and navigate like that. But then you have to move your hand to the mouse, and that's inefficient, right? You can also do Control Tab for switching between kind of like the most recently opened files that you have. So if I let's open up main.cpp file as well. So if I'm working in the header file and the CPP, you can see those two are now at the top. So it works exactly like Alt Tab does in your window manager. And additionally, I can do Alt Left and Alt Right to also move between the most recently opened files, if I want to do so. In addition to this, we do have what's called a locator. So if I close all of the files, just for the sake of the demo, and pressing Control K, that brings up the locator in the bottom left with quite an extensive menu. And now I can simply start typing, because I know the name of the files I want to open. I want to open my widget. So I start typing my widget, or my wid in this case. And it gives me a list of the file names containing this string in my project. Not on the entire disk, but in my project. And I want to see the header file, so I go there and press return, and I'm being brought to the header file. So that's quite convenient, simply for just browsing around in your code if you know the file names. If you don't know the file name, but you do know the class, you can do Control K, press C, and then spell it correctly. So C is for class, so you can find your MyWidget class in this case, and simply just press return and you get there. Or additionally, if you're looking for a specific method or any method called, in this case, delete item, you do M and then start typing delete item, and it finds the method delete item. And this again ties down to the code model that Qt Creator uses, so it actually knows your code more than simply being for highlighting. What else? Well, colon, if you're looking for a specific function and you know which class it is in, you know what its name is, you do colon, and then you start typing my widget, colon delete item, and you're there. Right. So this is quite convenient. I don't have a Git project I can show you, unfortunately. But if this would have been a Git project, I could also have done Git blame on this file, and I would actually get the file in its current state with annotations for each line, who wrote this, and in which commit. And you can click the commit or browse through the commit and see the entire change log for that specific, or the entire diff for that specific commit. So that's quite convenient as well. So this is kind of like the most powerful tool inside of Qt Creator that you want to use. You can also go and browse for files on the file system as well, but simply by pressing F and then start typing away. Additionally, there is a shortcut for Control L to just go to a specific line. So line 10, for example, I'm getting there. Right. So last point actually I want to show you is the debugger. Let's see, well, if I build this now, it's going to fail. So let's make it build. Ah. So Control B is for building, and I'm getting the compile output. And it's, well, it's finished, so that works. Because, I mean, go to the My Widget and put a breakpoint simply by clicking in the margin. That's nothing specific for Qt Creator. And then we launch the debugger. So now we're in debugging mode. And we get to see our backtrace on how we ended up where we are. We get to see our breakpoints. And we also get to see our locals and member variables and whatnot. And this is quite convenient because if you're using GDB out of the box on the command line, you would not see Sweden CPP because this is a Q string. You will see something like this. It will be like a D pointer, and you know, it's like QRA data and lots of just internal stuff. But since Qt Creator adds these debugging helpers, you actually get to see the actual content of QString, and these applies to more or less, as far as I know, all the different Qt types. So QColor, QByte array, QRect, QSize, etc. Of course, you can do this from the command line as well, but it takes a bit of setup to get right. It's for me, it's easier to just make sure this checkbox is checked and you're good to go.
Can you add those for your custom classes?
Yeah, but that's more GDB specific. So you need to add like pretty printers for your own classes. I think it's Python code that you need to write them in. I'm not a GDB expert, so I wouldn't know where, but yeah, you can. I do still have some time, so I want to show you sessions as well. So we're stopping the debugging session. Because the session manager is quite convenient to use when you're working on multiple projects with different setups and whatnot, and you have to switch between them quickly. So now we have our project here. We have the three files opened, main, my widget, and my widget.h. We're moving this into a specific or a separate session. So I'm bringing up the session manager, and I'm cloning this one, and we call it Sweden CPP. I'm choosing create and open, and then could have skipped the open. Moving back to the default one, I can now close this current project and close all files and create a new one, because right now I'm in the default session. So let's do not sure where this is taking me. Let's do just a library, default. So now we're doing a library development in this specific session. So I'm having my library.tpp file open and maybe the library global. But now, let's say, okay, so somebody comes, hey, can you help me with this specific issue on this specific project? You can instantly go back to your session in the Sweden CPP project and immediately continue where you left off. So you still got your files open, you still got your kit selected depending on what you had. So that makes it quite convenient to switch between different projects. And of course, you get to see them on your welcome screen as well when you open up Qt Creator. Right, that's it for the demo. Any questions? Very, very quiet.
About the refactoring? Is there more refactoring than...
Well, yeah, there are. Let's say we will move this into a specific function. Again, you press Alt Return, select some code, press Alt Return, and you extract it into another function. that adds it, calls it, of course. What else is there? There's supposed to be some C++. There we go. Well, you can move a definition, rename the symbol. We can actually do that because we are looking at this one, or this function definition. And again, press Control Shift R, and that actually renames it, or we can rename it wherever we want to be. It renames it in every occasion where it's mentioned. So we mention it, or we rename it to do a loop, and it renames it. In here, it renames it where we call it, and of course also in the header file. Did you have any specific refactorings in mind?
No, just having the last Sweden CPP meeting with C line.
Right. Yeah, I didn't see that one. Oh. But what do they have for refactorings? Okay. Not sure this, well, we have a rename. I'm sure there's more, but I can't think of them right now. There's one thing. You can switch, let's see, in this case we have two parameters. You can press Alt Return. Again, it's like the magic shortcut. Switch with the previous parameters. We do that, and then it kind of just switches to. And we have to apply this function signature changes, so it's applied to the CPP side as well. Anyway, yeah?
I have a favorite. I wrote rollable in the Q property.
Right. Oh, yes, that. Yes. Thank you. I actually remember that as you were doing your Q property, but yeah, I need to show that. Yes. So we want to add a Q property. Come on. It should actually show me completion now. There we go. So you added like an int value, right?
Yeah.
So we're saying the type is int, the name is value, and our read function would be value, and then it kind of completes for us the set value and the value changed functions. So I'm done there, and I'm good, and I have my property. Macro listed, but I don't have any functions for this. So I press Alt Return again. That's the kind of magic shortcut, and I get generate missing Q property members. And this gives me the getter function, it gives me the setter function, and it gives me the signal. So everything is already implemented. I don't need to type all of that C++ code myself. And then since we're now getting them in the header file, I can simply just do Alt Return on them and move them out to the CPP file instead. Yes, thank you for reminding me.
That's the best one.
Yeah. Anything else? Yeah.
Yeah. Can you write your own script to generate, you know, some border code?
Well, yes. You can create your own kind of templates for creating, or well, you can create your own wizards, and you can create your own code templates for inserting boilerplate. Anything else? No? Okay. Then that's it for me. Two things to remember, Control K and Alt Enter. Control K brings up the locator, and you can find everything in your code from there. Alt Enter brings up the refactoring tool and general helper menu. Again, contribute if you're feeling motivated to get your name on the list of an IDE that's quite commonly used actually in the Qt world. Just clone the repo and get started. And just for plugging myself, or at least the company I work for, we're on Twitter if you want to follow some pretty cool Qt stuff that we do. And we also have a newsletter with pretty low volume. It's like one email a month. So if you're feeling more interested in Qt, sign up for that one. Because it I'm not just saying this because I worked there, but it's quite cool stuff. And if you're lazy, simply like me, you can give me your email address instead and I will add it to you. We do not sell your email address. That I can promise. All right, so that's it for me. Thank you for having me, and I hope I was able to teach you something. All right, thanks.